let them know you heard about us. Let me know. We are also organizing Rudy Golf Portugal, which is about a month from now. It's going to be awesome. We have Eric Patterson there, you with the cast. Gary Miller is going to be there as well, Martin Fowler, and our MC is going to be BJ, so it's going to be awesome. Please do come. Now, moving on to Crystal. Crystal is an efficient Ruby-like language. This is one of the main features of the language. So efficiency is important. The Ruby-like is not as important, but it definitely makes sense for people coming from the Ruby community. So it has static checks. It's a compiled language. It's not interpreted as Ruby is. So you're going to see some differences because of that. It has very simple C bindings, and mostly because it's LLVM compiled, so anything LLVM just works. I'm going to show some examples. It's self-hosted. What I mean by this is that Crystal is 100% written in Crystal, which is nice, at least it was for me when I was looking at the language, because in Ruby, because I'm not a very good C programmer, there's some parts that I don't really understand that well. And in Crystal, because everything was Crystal, I could kind of figure out how everything was connected. I was able to work a little bit on the parser and the lexer, which is nice. They consider it to be a modern language, and what they mean by modern is that it has OAuth, OAuth2, WebSockets, Markdown, all of that comes in the standard lib. So that's why they call it a modern language. Now, that's like a quick overview of the language. Let's look at a few examples of these features. So as I said, it has static checks, but most of it comes from having types. So it's a typed language. It has pretty good type inference, which means that most of the time you're going to be able to write it as you write like your regular Ruby, for those of you that write Ruby. So something like this, it's pretty hard to see, sorry. So it says number equals 42, and you can just print number. It's going to be 42, we print the class, it's going to be an int 32. These were just fine, that was the point I was trying to make. Like, you don't have to tell it the type as you would in something like Java. So it's not that kind of type, because it is able to infer that. If you try with arrays, you have numbers equals an array with 1 and 2, and then you shuffle. And for those not familiar with Ruby, that less than sign is called a shuffle operator. It just puts something at the end of the array. And again, it just works. It tells you that it's an array of int 32s. It's able to infer that. So pretty easy to get started, and not a lot of, it doesn't stand in your way. Now, so that was pretty simple, but now what do you want if you want to do some like heterogeneous arrays? Like, you have an array, you initialize it with the same two integers, you shuffle an integer, and now you shuffle a string into it. If you try to run this, this will blow up at compile time and say, it's a pretty readable error. I don't know if you can read because of the sun, but it says no overload matches array int 32 shuffle operator with type string. So what this pretty much is telling you is you cannot shuffle a string into an array of ints. Doesn't make sense. I cannot work with that. There's a couple of ways of working around it in Crystal. One of those is to, when initializing the array, pass in all the types that you want. So you can initialize an array with integers and strings, then it will just work. It will be an array of integer union with string. And these would, like, how these union types work will be apparent in a short minute or two. Another way of doing it is because, like, this is not very convenient, that at initialization time of your variable, you have to know all of the types, and or you have to have an instance of all the stuff that you want to put there. So you can say it's an array of numbers, it has integers, but it's an array of, and then you say the type. So you can declare the type that it's gonna have eventually. Okay, so this is the first situation that we have seen where Crystal differs from Ruby. So as I said, it's Ruby-like, so it should be pretty familiar if you're coming from a Ruby background, but it's definitely not Ruby. It has a lot of different things. Even though it tries to follow the same mentality of Ruby of being easy for the programmer and being pleasant for the programmer, that's kind of the mentality as well, but it's not the same language. As I said, it has static checks. So now that we understand the type system that Crystal uses, like Crystal can actually do a lot of things for you at compile time, as usually compile languages do. So let's look at this example in Ruby. And again, I'm sorry if you're not familiar with Ruby, but I think it's the code is simple enough that it's pretty readable. If you could read anything. So it's, I have defined a method called string size, takes a string and just calls size on it and prints what that size is. In Ruby, if I do that and pass in a string, it will give me the number of characters in the string, works fine. If I pass in nil, and here I'm passing nil explicitly, but this could be a variable that holds nil, you get an undefined method size for the nil class. And this is a pretty common error if you ever worked with Ruby using this a lot. You get like a nil error like right in your face. Sometimes you'll know where it comes from, sometimes you won't. And this happens like in runtime, because that's how Ruby works. If we try the same thing in Crystal, the syntax is again the same. Have a method, string size, takes a string, and just prints it out. It will explode. It'll say undefined method size for nil. Pretty much the same error, but you'll get it at compile time. Right? So no change, no chance of pushing these up to production or any other source of environment. I don't have it here, but the error is pretty much is a lot larger than this. So Crystal brings a stack trace of where your nil may be coming from. So it tries to figure out where the nil has originally been put into place. So trying to help you out, something that Ruby does not have, and it's pretty useful. So going back to the example that we had with the array. So let's say we want to do this. We have an array, we say it's a union type of string and int 32, so we can put strings and integers there, that's fine. And now we want to print state. So we know that the last element of the array is going to be a string, because we're doing it. And we have to take it out and print the size. In Ruby, this would just work, so that's fine. In Crystal, it does not. It says undefined method size for int 32, and now it even tries to even help you more and say the compile time type that I think that you have for this this array is int 32 union with string. So what this is actually saying is that this array can be either of ints or strings. So you cannot call size of it, because ints do not have the method size. It's not possible because I cannot make sure that this last element is going to be a string, even though like, looking at this example, you know it is. In general, you cannot infer that. However, Crystal allows you to make sure that it's a string, and then it allows you to call size of it. So the way you do it is, you take the last element, you call is a string in it, on that element, and inside the conditional, then you are sure that it's a string, so you can call any string methods on it, even though the array is of the union type of both. So this is like the pretty like smart way that Crystal has for you to do these operations. Even though you have a heterogeneous array, you can call methods for one of those types. Okay. So moving on, we have C bindings. My experience with Ruby, and again, sorry, like I come from the Ruby, I have a Ruby background, so I make a comparison a lot with Ruby, but I actually never wrote a C binding in Ruby, and every time I look at it, it's pretty daunting. It's not very easy to get started, in my opinion. You most of the times need to write C, which again, I'm not very comfortable with, and you need to know Ruby's C implementation, like the structs, the methods it uses, because like that's what you're going to have to use. There's a project in Ruby called Fiddle, which it looks nicer, like has a DSL that you can use, but even though it's not like a native citizen to the language at all. In Crystal, it's much easier to do that. Like, for instance, we have here the A to I function that comes from libc, and you just declare libc, and then you have the header of the function, and you can use it in your regular Crystal code. That's it. Well, this is cheating a little bit because libc is already in the standard lib of Crystal, so you can just use it like that. So if it was a library that's not the standard lib of Crystal, so any other C library or LLVM compatible for that matter, you could just use that little tag there where you say link read So that's what the C function returns. It's a pointer, and Crystal implements that. It has the notions of pointers, and you can capture a pointer and make it into an actual string in the language. So pointers exist. They are not something you should be using in your regular day-to-day use of the language. So it's something you can use to make the transition from C to the language, but not something you should be using otherwise. Most of the core of Crystal uses this kind of stuff, so they were, I think, pretty smart in doing it to leverage a lot of the things that the C community has already done. So, for instance, the garbage collector, and I think still to this point, is not implemented at all in Crystal. They just took like one that was implemented in C, even though it might not be the best one, but like it works, yeah, it's been working for a few times. Just use that. So this is something that you need, but you don't want to care about right now, and give them the opportunity to work on some other stuff. And they've done that with a few things, and over the course of the year or 2 years that Crystal has been going on, like they have been re-implementing some of the stuff to be more specific to Crystal, but it gives us the power to not have to worry about some things we don't want to. So pretty clever, I think. Another feature that Crystal has, as a lot of type languages do, is generics. So again, looking at Ruby, if you would have I have a class foo that has a natural reader, that's a getter for an instance variable called value, and a constructor that takes the value and just initializes it. Pretty simple. In Ruby, I can just create a foo of integers, and I get the value, I call the absolute on it, I get 1, it works. If I do the same thing with a character, I get the ASCII value for that character, and it just works. So Ruby, we're very fan of this duck typing thing, and everything kind of just works. In Crystal, it's a little bit different. So if I do it like the same thing, I just change from attReader to getter, because that's what Crystal calls it. They have getters, setters, and properties instead of attReaders, writers, and attAccessories in Ruby. It also has the addValue, like CoffeeScript kind of thing, where in the initialization, the constructor of the class, you don't have to say value and then inside of the body say addValue equals value, which is kind of annoying to be honest. Like you can just do addValue there and it just works. But if I try to do the same thing now, instantiated with an integer and then instantiated with a character, and then call integer and character methods on it, it's going to break. The error has changed a little bit over time, but it's still going to break. Here it says, I cannot infer the type of instance variable value of foo. So this is like, but it does not allow you to do something like this. You cannot call this method with different value, with different types and everything. So one way to work around it is like, oh, you cannot infer the type, then let me tell you the type. Let's say value is an int. Well, now it breaks because it says there's no overload for foo.new, there's no constructor for the type character because it's an int. So you kind of like, if that's all you knew, if there were no generics, which we're going to see how to do in a little bit, or the next slide actually, is like you would be stuck. Like there would be no way out of this. Or it could be a union, and you have the problems we talked about with unions before, where like when you call a method, it has to satisfy all of the types in the union. So the way to do that with generics is just say it's a foo of t. T is a generic variable or type variable, and just say value will be the one defining what t is. That's what that means. So now I can do foo of integer, and so that value will define that the foo is actually a foo of integers, and then I have a foo of characters, and it just works. So this is what internally hashes and arrays use in order to have this functionality where you can create an array of whatever you want, and not every array that you create are going to be like this massive union type of everything you've ever used in an array, so each array is independent. It's the expected behavior, but like this is how it works. Another very cool feature that I find in Crystal is method overloading. So in not have two methods with the same or with the same name, basically. If they have the same name, even if they have different arities. Like they're not. It's not gonna work. Ruby's gonna complain. In Crystal, you can have the same name for a method, but if it has a different arity or if it has a different type signature, it's considered a different method. Another thing is what in Crystal they call yieldness, which is kind of a strange name, but it means that if somewhere in the code you're gonna yield to a block. So this is something also a little bit specific to Ruby, but it means that you, so in Ruby you have like implicit closures that you can pass to a method, and if you're using those, if Crystal has the same, if you're using those, then it's a different method again, because it's like you're having an extra argument, even though it's implicit. So let's look at an example. So the Ruby example is that whole thing, and it's just a method, even though if you can't see the specifics, it doesn't really matter as well. So this is handling three different situations for a method called sum. So one, you take two strings, you convert them to integers, you sum them. Another, you just take an integer and you just print that out. Not very useful, but it shows the example I wanted to show. And the other, you take sum of two anythings and you just try to call plus on them. So it might break in some situations, but in general, that's what it's going to do. The same thing in Ruby is much more complex. You have to take a variable number of arguments and then do a switch statement on that. And if it's two arguments, then do something. Or if it's two arguments, see if they're both strings, if they are something, if not, sum them. If it's one, do something else, raise an error. So it's not like great. People have found out a lot of ways to work around it, and it's mostly okay, but I like method overloading a lot. It's a feature I enjoy in languages in general, that and pattern matching, which Crystal does not have, but would be great. So this is also something that I don't think is ever going to happen in Ruby, method overloading, but if you want to try it out in a Ruby-like syntax, you can try Crystal. I'm going to talk a little bit about how Crystal handles concurrency. There's a couple ways you can do it. There's mutexes and there's semaphores and all that kind of stuff is in there, but I'm not sure you're going to want to deal with it. At least I wouldn't. So one thing they did not too long ago is that they kind of borrowed their concurrency model from Go a little bit. So they tried to mimic what Go does, at least its API. I don't know about the internals, but I'm pretty sure they're not the same. But the API, the way the Go channels work, is similar to the way that the Crystal channels work. So in Crystal, I have the example of Go, and if my Go code is terrible, I'm sorry, I have no idea what I'm doing there. But the Crystal example kind of correlates a little bit. So let's go with the Go first. You have the main function. You have make, shen, string, so I'm assuming it creates a channel for strings. And then you have the function, so like go func thing that's happening there that will happen eventually. And then you have a print statement, and you're getting stuff from that messages channel and printing it. So the way this is going to work in Go is that it's going to print before receive. Then because the main thread, I don't know if that's the name you call it in Go, is going to be waiting for the process to go. Like it's going to go, it's going to print before send, it's going to send a message, print after send, and then you'll print the message. Hope I'm not too off here, but like this is mostly I think how it goes. Crystal is slightly different, but it's similar if you kind of squint your eyes. So you see, I created channel string.new, so creating a channel for strings, same thing. Spawn, so spawn is going to create that thing that's going to be running in a different thread. So it's kind of like a coroutine is what we call it. And then you have the same thing, the same print statements and the same channel send, just the syntax a little bit different. And then I'm printing before receive and the channel receive, so because channel receive will return the message, I can just print that. So in result is gonna go before receive, same thing, channel receive will go to the spawn process, before send, then it's gonna print the message, then after send does not print, and I believe this is because Crystal is not parallel yet, so it's running on a real thread with its own scheduler, so it's kind of sends a message and like, because the main process ends, like it just ends everything, so you never see the after send. One way to work around it a little bit is that Crystal has, so these things, these coroutines are called fibers in Crystal, and the one thing you can do is you can call, so this is the exact same code I had in Crystal, but before the before receive, I have a fiber.yield, and that means, hey, I don't need to do whatever I was going to do right now. If anyone's waiting to do some work, they can. Which the spawn product, the spawn fiber there can just pick it up and say, hey, I have some work to do. And it brings before send, it sends the message. Yeah, it sends the message. And once it sends the message, the other thread will start from where it started, from the yield. So it will print before receive, and then we'll print the message. If I wanted to see the after send, I could have a fiber yield after channel receive, right? So the last instruction would be a fiber yield. That means, okay, I'm just gonna, kind of like a join, we would do it like in other languages. So I'm just gonna wait here for someone else to finish whatever work they have. This is how you would implement your channels in Crystal. It's something that you don't have to be anything like this, but I find it's interesting. So kind of to wrapping it up here, this was a bit fast, but there's this thing in Crystal Core called charts, which in Ruby we call gems, or we'll call like libraries everywhere else. So yeah, we try to find strange names for libraries for some reason, but in Crystal they're called charts. And the way you use it is pretty interesting, I would say. So if you have a chart, there's a charts project, and there's a shard YAML. So the shards project is the dependency manager thing, because everyone has to have one. And you have the shard YAML, it's a YAML file, you just declare dependencies. You have your production dependencies, your development dependencies, pretty standard, that thing. And then you just use it, you require it there. This all seems pretty great. The one thing that is interesting about it, I think, is that it's decentralized. So there is no, I don't know if Nick's here yet still, or like there's no Ruby gems, and it's, they don't want it to be, like it all works on GitHub for now and Bitbucket. So anything that has a Git URL that you can point to, you can get your code from, and you can use it locally as well. You can point to sort of local projects. So being decentralized has some like issues that you have to work with that probably you don't think about them a lot when you have like a centralized place where you can push all your libraries. And the biggest one, I think, is discovery. So finding libraries, it's kind of hard. There's no place where you can look. There's no official place where you're like, hey, like this is where the real gems are. There's none of that. So when I first started working with Crystal a little bit, there was really nothing. So I created this this website, which, as far as I know, one of the first in production in Crystal, and called Crystal Charts. It's pretty ugly, but it did the job. It uses the GitHub search API to look for projects, and you're gonna see the problem here, to look for projects for which Crystal is the main language. Because as far as I know, and there's GitHub people here that can correct me, like that was the only way to search for things in GitHub. And the problem here is that it's twofold. So for one, you can have a natural library, like that Crystal is not their main language, and it's not gonna show up. Or the other way around, you can have an app that is mostly Crystal, but it's not library, and it will show up. So it hasn't been too much of a problem because we have some ways of starting it, and by default it's sorted by stars, and the ones that have more stars are usually libraries and good ones. So not because of the old yet, but it might be, and I think it's something they will have to address sooner or later. Not sure. So there's this, then someone made a more beautiful, like it's pretty much the same thing, has the same functionality, but it's prettier. So there's this thing, crystal shards, XYZ, XYZ, like you can put that up. You can see the main crystal libraries, which, well, again, like you can see crystal is there. Crystal is not really a library, but it's the language, but it's mostly written in crystal, so it shows up there as the main one. There's Kamal, which is the Sinatra-like thing. Amethyst is kind of the same thing. You even have Awesome Crystal, which you're familiar with, the Awesome-whatever projects. It's pretty much just a list of other nice crystal things. So, but it's up there as like one of the major libraries. So it's you can see kind of the issues here. Yeah, so that was pretty much it. Thanks.